Thanks for joining us. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Lord, we thank you for the many blessings which you have poured into our lives. Now we ask your blessing on these gifts that they may be used to your glory. Amen. Our scripture reading for today is Exodus 16, verses 2 through 5, the contemporary English version. There in the desert, they started complaining to Moses and Aaron. We wish the Lord had killed us in Egypt. When we lived there, we could at least sit down and eat all the bread and meat we wanted. But you have brought us out here into this desert where we are going to starve. The Lord said to Moses, I will send bread down from heaven like rain. Each day the people can go out and gather only enough for that day. That's how I will see if they obey me. But on the sixth day of each week, they must gather and cook twice as much. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. Well, good morning. I'm Karen Taylor. I'm pastor of Mission and Discipleship here at First United Methodist Church, and I want to add my words of welcome to those watching on the live stream or joining us on Facebook Live or watching us later on TV today. We're so grateful that you are here with us, and we pray that God will bless you as we gather together today. And we are inviting you to participate in the sermon today, so if you haven't gone there already, we invite you to go to this website, menti.com. menti.com, and when invited, type in the code 317869. You don't need to worry about the dashes, and there'll be two questions, so you'll answer the first one, and then you may need to wait for the second one, but thank you for hopping on and being a part of our message today through this survey in just a few moments. Well, today we are beginning a two-week series called The Power of Money, where we are going to look at the spiritual practice of generosity. And generosity is a practice that blesses not only the recipient of our generosity, but it also brings blessing to the giver. It's a practice that reflects God's character, and it empowers us to do good in the world. As we dive into this series today, we're going to explore the power of money to create. Would you pray with me? God, we're grateful for the many ways you bless us in this life, and help us to open our hearts to the ways you are inviting us to be a blessing to others as we look at our ability to be generous. We ask that you bless now the words of our mouths and the meditations of our heart, that they are acceptable in your sight. For you, O God, are our rock, you are our strength, you are our redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. So money is a powerful force in our lives. We spend much of our lives in pursuit of making money. We look for ways to generate more income. We get education or training with the hope of developing skills that enable us to have a good salary. We invest for our kids' college. We save for retirement. Hopefully we have an emergency fund for times like the times we are currently in. We have accountants and CPAs who help us with tax advice so we can keep as much of our income as possible. And if our income is on the lower end of things, we also feel the power of money as we try to make ends meet, to pay rent, to pay utilities, to get the necessities of life. Money is a powerful force in our lives. It's also an emotional force as well. And let's listen to how money is an emotional force in your life as well as we look at the Menti survey. Hopefully you've had a chance to jump on there. And Jack, if you can help get that up on the screen so we can see some of the results. And so the first question was, are you a spender or a saver? And so you can see all that popping up there. And goodness, it looks like we're about half and half. That's pretty amazing. Oh, savers just bumped up by one. All right, so that's pretty typical. That's what we would expect, probably half and half for spenders and half for savers, or at least that's how you identify yourself. So if we could go to the next question. The next question is, when you hear the word money, what words or emotions or feelings come to mind? And I'm going to need some help reading those. So let's see what, so there's a few words up there. What do we have? Freedom, greed, guilt, providing for my family, not going to have enough, stress. Any other responses going to pop up? Stressful. Spending, security, savings, hopeful for retirement, grateful. Okay, so keep, what was that? Concern. So you can see, and there are more, and we'll look at these, we'll show these again later, but as you can see, there's lots of emotion, isn't there, around the word money. It stirs up positive emotions, it stirs up negative emotions, and many of those are concerns, aren't they? Stressful, concern, greed, fear of the future. Money has a powerful force in our lives. And money can have power over our lives, or we can use the power of money for good, including the power to create. So when we talk about creating or creativity, we know that it is broader than what we might typically think. We often think of creativity in terms of art, like painting or music or drama, and it certainly is those things. But creativity is more than those important disciplines. You see, creativity is a process, it's a way of living. Creativity builds and not destroys. It answers a question. Creativity helps someone. It expresses ideas. And with all of these activities, when we create, we make wonder. Wonder for ourselves, but wonder also for those who benefit from our work. You see, money has the power to do all of these things. Money has the power to create, which is vital for the well-being of our world. Sir Ken Robinson says this, "Creativity is not a luxury. It is essential for our personal security and fulfillment." It is important, essential for personal security and fulfillment. So what is it about our lives that hinders our creativity? What hinders us from using our money and our resources to create? The primary thing that hinders our creativity is fear. Fear is the great creativity killer. When we are afraid, our brain, the rational part of our brain, starts to shut down, and we move into survival mode, and we react to things rather than to think through things creatively. And we see the effects of fear in the story in the Bible about manna in Exodus 16. You may recall that this event of the manna is part of the Exodus story, where God's people are delivered from slavery in Egypt and are on their way to the promised land. Moses is called by God to lead the people out of Egypt to the promised land. And in dramatic fashion, the Israelites are released from their slavery of Egypt. 400 years they'd spent in slavery. And they escape Pharaoh's armies when God opens up the Red Sea for them to cross through. And now they're in this wilderness place, this place between Egypt and the Promised Land, between their place of slavery and their destination. They're in the part of the story where routine is starting to set in. The exhilaration of their escape from bondage is starting to fade, and the future is uncertain. And they're in this wilderness place, this desert, and all that is in sight for them is sand and rock. And how could there possibly be enough food for all of these people when all you see around you is barren wilderness? And so the people start to complain to Moses. And in fact, they're complaining to God. And ironically, the people began to long for Egypt, their place where they were in bondage for 400 years. They preferred the familiar bondage to the uncertain future that lay before them. And they began to dream of this abundance of food that existed only in their minds. Fear is driving their response. And they seem to forget that the God who saved them, who brought them so dramatically out of Egypt, is enough to care for them, even in this wilderness place. So God says that food will come. God will rain down bread from heaven each day, but just enough for each day. They were to gather every morning what they needed, and the food was there in the morning, and by noon, what was there evaporated away. On the sixth day, they were instructed to gather enough for 2 days so that the Sabbath could be a day of rest. And sure enough, every morning they found the ground covered with something they had never seen before. Verses 14 and 15 say, "When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." Once again, God's word was true to them. Food was provided. But even with this provision, fear began to set in, and the people began to hoard. They were again instructed to only gather what they needed for the day. And an interesting thing in the story is, regardless of how much they gathered, what they wound up with is what they needed for that day. And they were told to consume everything that they gathered that day. They were not to keep any overnight. And they were to do this as an expression of trust in God, that God would do what God had said. Yet fear of not having enough, fear of not having enough set in, and people began to save some back, keeping it overnight. The people began to hoard their resources. And in the morning, they found the manna they had kept overnight was full of worms, and it stank. It was foul. Rather than trust God, they tried to hoard what was given. We're not much different than that today, are we? When we're afraid, we're prone to hoard. We're prone to hold things close to us. We're prone to gather things in and not share of what we have. We see that when a snowstorm is forecast, bread and milk and eggs fly off of the shelves. And we've seen it in this pandemic, haven't we? With toilet paper, toilet paper of all things. When we're afraid, we hoard. We even hoard crazy things. And when we hoard, it begins to turn sour on us. Did you hear the story this week of the man from Australia who had bought up a lot of packages of toilet paper and was selling it on eBay at an exorbitant price? Well, eBay shut him down, and the man tried to return the extra items he had to the store. The store manager, knowing what he was doing, refused to have him return those items. So what he had tried to hoard became a stinking mess to him. When we are afraid, our ability to create stalls. And instead of using the resources that God has given us as a blessing to ourselves and to others, we focus on ourselves, and it becomes a stinky mess in our lives. And just like the Israelites, fear keeps us from trusting and honoring God, and we fail to use the resources that God has given us as God intends. Money is a powerful force, and it can hold power over us, creating fear and discontent, or we can exercise power over money and unleash its power to create something new, to create something beautiful, something good, something that benefits not only ourselves, but benefits others as well. So how do we do that? Well, we do that by, first of all, looking at the emotional attachment to money and how that attachment drives our decisions of how we use the money that we have. So think about your responses to the Menti survey, and it can give you a clue to your attachment to money and how you're using those resources. We know that marketing is designed to create discontent within us. They try to tell us that we would be happier, or our life would be better or easier if we just bought that product. And marketers exercise power of money over our lives. But we know that money is essential for our lives, for our well-being. We can't navigate this life without money. And in fact, studies demonstrate that money does contribute to our happiness. For example, money allows us to live longer and healthier lives by, first of all, giving us access to health care. Money buffers us against worry and harm. That happens when we have enough to have an emergency fund. It allows us to have leisure time to spend with friends and family. It allows us to control our daily activities that we enjoy. And all of those things contribute to sources of happiness in our lives. Studies also confirm that having, just because you have more money, doesn't contribute to greater happiness. In fact, those studies say that the extremely wealthy are typically not any more, if any, happier than people that have an average income. So the question becomes, if money can buy happiness, why doesn't it? One writer says it this way: money is amoral, yet magnetic. It is amoral, yet magnetic. Amoral meaning it's neither good nor bad. Money is simply a tool that can be used to help or to harm. But it is also magnetic, which means it draws people in. And the only way to have power over the magnetism of money is to show money who is boss. And one of the ways that we show money who is boss is through generosity, giving our money away, sharing our resources with others. So what are some of the benefits of generosity? The first benefit is we are actually happier when we give money away. In a well-known study where they gave people money that they could either spend on themselves or spend on someone else, the people who spent money on others were happier. Another benefit of money is we participate in what we deem as important. The scripture says, Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Whatever we give our money toward shows what we value. We show what is important to us by the way we spend our money. It shows our desire to invest in something important in the world, something that is making a difference. A third benefit of generosity is it releases the power of money from us. Marcus Brotherton tells about a person he worked with years ago who at a young age knew that he was strongly attracted to making money. And he knew he didn't want money to have power over him, that he wanted to resist the temptation of making decisions based purely on economic gain. And so he conducted a personal experiment. And in this experiment, he started to give things away while continuing to work his business as normal. And the items that he started with were small at first: a sweater that he valued, a book that he enjoyed and wanted to keep, a gift certificate to a fancy restaurant. And at first, it was hard for him to do it. He was troubled by it, even disappointed at the things he gave away. But then he began to notice a strange pattern. Even though he would work toward giving without expecting a reward, he found that rewards often came his way. And it seemed that whatever he gave away, he received something of greater value in return, often intangible things. Sometimes it was simply self-respect. Sometimes it was a boost in his mood. Sometimes it was a return favor. Sometimes it was a happy customer who diverted business his way. And today, this man is a wealthy man. His business is booming. But he continues to be a huge giver, giving to organizations that promote education and international relief. This man discovered that the less he made money his focus and his goal, the more successful he became. Rather than selling out for short-term gain, he was free to make his own choices about his craft, and he began to create things of lasting value. Money has the power to create, the power to create a better world. Wayne Muller, in his book Sabbath, says, "Our wealth arises from our capacity to bless and be blessed. We are not blessed because we are wealthy. We are wealthy because we take time to bless. We are wealthy because we take time to bless." Money has power. But does money have power over you? Or do you have power over your money? Using that power of money to create a better world. So what is your relationship to money? How did you answer that survey question? Is fear keeping you from contributing to the good of our community? Is fear causing you to hoard resources? Is a consumeristic spirit stealing life from you? Or do you think it all depends on you? Do you recognize that what you have, your ability to work, to create, to build, is a gift from God? A gift given not only to bless yourself, but to bless others. We are living in unprecedented times, but in spite of that, it is also a time full of possibilities to create something good and something beautiful, something that will create a better world. And we may think that we don't have the power to do that. We may think that our gift is too small. Yet we know that God takes ordinary, simple things and creates something more out of it. Like today, as we share communion together, God takes ordinary juice or bread or whatever items you are gathering together and creates us into a community, creates us into God's family. Even though we're not in the same room, we're still community, still family, gathered together. And that is the power to create something good, the power that God gives us as God's children as well. Money is a powerful force in our world. Money is a powerful force in our lives. Will it have power over you, resulting in fear and discontent and hoarding? Or will you harness the power of money and create something good that for yourself, but for others, something that honors God? And so this coming week, what's one small step you can take? One small step you can take to use the power of money to create a better world. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we are thankful again for your many blessings in our lives and for the resource of money that you bring our way. And help us to recognize that all that we have is a gift from you. And help us to hear how you are inviting us to create a better world as we use those resources to bless not only our own needs, but to help build a better world and bless others. In your name we pray. Amen. Let me